The following podcast is a presentation of This Is Infamous. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to the CineFiles Podcast, Mr. Bob. And it's episode 17 of the CineFiles Podcast. I am the producer and guest host, Eric Cohen. With me is Andre Joseph, also co-host of the CineFiles. Say hello, Andre.
Greetings.
And we have Jeff Galishaw, co-host of the CineFiles, host of Unfinished Business, and producer of Unfinished Business. Say hello, Jeff.
Salutations.
And so we got a lot to talk about today. The main topic discussion is basically what I would call a state of the industry discussion. We'll talk about numbers, box office numbers, the business of Hollywood, how it's changed in the last two or three decades. But before we do that, we're going to start off in our usual way. We're going to talk about the films we've most recently seen since our last podcast recording. So, Jeff, tell us something you've seen recently.
I've seen a lot, but the one that I would find most interesting to talk about would be a little film that came out in 1982 that I saw for the first time this week. It stars a young Clint Howard, and its name is Evil Speak.
Evil Speak. I was gonna ask if that was gonna be it.
Yes.
Evil Speak. I have fond memories of Evil Speak, but I haven't seen it in a long time.
I think it is my new favorite bad movie that I really would love to remake. It's just so amazing to me. Okay, first of all, Clint Howard is supposed to be this military school student whose parents died. Now, of course, he looks way too old. And I think they try to cover up that he's balding by then pushing all of his hair into bangs. And also, he really wants to play on the soccer team, even though he's horrible at it, apparently. So these were the first few things that appealed to me in this film, other than us apparently witnessing a druid, sacrifice in the beginning with Richard Mall, who played Bull on Night Court. As the main person killing the fair maiden. But then Dwayne from What's Happening pops up as the one minority student in this whole film. And, I mean, he's Clint Howard's best friend, I guess, in this film. But he really serves no purpose in this film whatsoever.
If I recall, it was kind of like Christine, but with a hard drive.
Yes, with a hard drive and no love interest. In fact, the one girl who kind of shows him some sympathy, then in that same scene, he gets beat up by, I guess, the guys who are picking on him throughout the film. And then the girl leaves with the guys. I was like, Jesus. So I think they went out of their way to just show nobody apparently likes him at all for just no real reason. Other than the fact that also in every scene, he seems to be sweaty for no reason.
Probably because they wanted to get to know his brother better.
I'm guessing, because I'm just like, this film, I was just amazed as it just kept going on and on and it kept getting more and more ridiculous. And then it had satanic possessed cannibalistic pigs.
Right.
I was like, this can't get any better. And a computer program in which the devil or demon is coming through.
I love how it's like one of the earliest uses of personal computers.
Yes.
It's a major plot, you know, trope in a film.
And it also shows you how far we've come also. And
right. Have you seen this, Andre?
I've actually never heard of this movie.
I'm surprised because you're like the 80s guy.
Yes, you have to see this. This is quintessential 80s horror.
Or Clint Essential. Haha, see what I did there?
I don't watch Happy Days.
I really enjoyed it more than I probably should have. And the only reason I have to give a shout out, the only reason I even heard of this film was because Clint Howard was interviewed by Mike White on the Projection Booth podcast, and he mentioned the title. And I, after hearing just Evil speak, I just wanted to see, what is that about?
And now you have.
Exactly. And, it's
and it has gone down in infamy in the mind of Jeff Galishaw.
Exactly. I loved it.
What else? What else have you seen?
I saw Me, Earl, and the Dying Girl.
Which you've been dying to see.
Yes, and I was even shocked that one person, one of our CineFiles followers, said they hated the film. And I went into it with an open mind. Now, keep in mind, I've read the book first before I saw the movie. So I think I liked the film, but I didn't love it. But that's probably because I knew what was going to happen. I knew where it was going to go. And since it differed from the book, maybe I'm going to be one of those people who says the book was better because it explained things a little bit more so that you understood them. Whereas in the film, it kind of, some stuff is just a passing reference, or some storylines are just dropped completely. But right. I think it's definitely worth seeing, especially if you're, you know, you're a real movie fan, I think, because there's so many film references in it. And I think the main character, since he is a wannabe filmmaker, he kind of embodies the spirit of a lot of, I guess, film geeks. So I say it's worth checking out. I will admit, the cinematography is a little distracting, but after a while, you get used to it, so it doesn't seem so much more of a stylish flourish, more that it might be needed for the film to set its kind of loose tone. Since they are teenagers and full of energy, the camera work is the same way. It's not as bad as, let's say, a Michael Bay film when it comes to the camera work and editing, where it's like, oh, we need another cut, we need another angle every 30 seconds for no real reason.
So it's the overindulgence in the cinematography editing tricks.
Yes, but at least here I can see a reason for it, whereas usually when a Michael Bay film, there is no reason for it other than that's his style, or he feels the audience is going to get bored if he keeps a shot going for too long. Hmm. This film, I expected it to be my number one film of the year. Unfortunately, it's not. But it is probably on my highly recommended list.
Okay, interesting. Is that it?
I also saw that I could talk about. I saw Spy with Melissa McCarthy.
I saw that too. We can talk about that.
I was surprised at how much I actually enjoyed the film. And I didn't expect much going in. And
best way I can describe it, it's for a film that's very bawdy. Mm-hmm. I would describe it as cute.
Yeah, I would go with that.
It was better than I expected. It has a lot of clever, like, ways of making fun of the super spy genre. What I did like about it most of all, you know, I'm surprised no one has said this in the reviews. It's a remake of the movie Get Smart, basically. Same plot, same kind of lead character. Character is getting no respect, really wants to get out in the field, you know, that kind of thing. And like the movie Get Smart, the main character turns out to be very competent as a field spy, as a field agent, which I liked about it too. It wasn't like she was bumbling or anything like that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, wow, how has no one made this comparison yet? It's almost the same movie. Even the little twist at the end is the same with regard to a certain character, right?
Oh, okay.
It's very similar movies, but I would say that Spy is the better film.
Obviously,
it's funnier throughout. Yeah, I love the guy that was like the Italian guy.
Oh, Peter Safritz. I don't know how to say his last name.
Actually, I work for MI6. How do you like my accent? I got it from Downton Abbey. He was very funny. Jason Statham, you know, everyone was talking about how funny he is in this. I thought it was okay. I thought it was a little annoying after a while, but
Well, I thought he was hilarious. I thought anytime he appeared, I was already dying.
Well, the funniest line was the one he said at the end, or like, nice soon. It's like, I made it myself, you know? the running gag, Andre, with Jason Statham's character, he's like this alpha male super spy, right, who's foul-mouthed and stuff, and he's always going on about how he wound up having to rip off his arm and climb, you know, a six-story building armless and blah, 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 because that's what we do as spies. And the stories get more and more ridiculous to the point where Melissa McCarthy, in a very droll way, say, I think you're lying. that's not even possible. You know? It just becomes this running gag. And that stuff with that element of it was kind of funny. But, yeah.
Well, I think if anything, it suffers from the same thing, like, Mission Impossible 4 suffered from, where the villain wasn't really that interesting.
Yeah, and she wasn't. But, you know, I kind of liked the idea that even though she was the villain,
mm-hmm.
they kind of liked each other.
Okay, yeah.
You kind of thing, you know, like the way they ended that. I thought that was interesting. I think they could have done more with that. It made it more interesting.
I'm hoping, though, I don't know, according to the box office numbers, which goes with our subject for later, if it's going to necessarily warrant a sequel, though.
Yeah, and McCarthy, man, she really threw herself in the role physically.
Yeah, this is, to me, the best she's been since.
That one fight scene that was actually, it was both comical, but was very well choreographed and very well shot and edited.
It's the best she's been since Bridesmaids.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I'd say that. I mean, I would say it's one of those films, Andre. Wait for it on cable or watch it on Netflix.
Sounds about right.
But it's not, by all means, you won't feel guilty for seeing it. Anything else?
That I could talk about, I saw PAULINE AT THE BEACH, which was a movie ages ago when we were doing a foreign film episode you had wanted me to see, and I never got my copy.
Eric Rohmer?
Huh?
Was that Eric Rohmer?
Yes, and I finally got to see it.
And what'd you think of it?
I loved it, though at first I thought I was going to be bored to death, but as it went on, I really got into it. Maybe it was the whole philosophical conversations, plus the fact that this is supposed to be some kind of minor comedy, where I didn't see anything that funny happen, but right. I really enjoyed it more than I thought I would.
Yeah, we discussed one of his films in our French New Wave episode, right?
I think it was My Night at Maud's.
And we were all pleasantly surprised by it, but we all had the same reaction. The way it started, we're all like, "Where's this going?"
Exactly. And yeah. I guess I'm having the same reaction with this film.
And the best way I can describe Eric Rohmer's work, Andre, it's I would say that. It's sort of the DNA for what would become, like, Linklater's, you know, Sunrise Sunset series.
Yes.
It has that vibe about it. It's just people talking, and you learn, and that's the arc, like, we're, you know, from the beginning to the end. And it's all about the dynamics and what's revealed about those characters, their hypocrisies, their complexities, all that stuff, within that, like, something that happens within a day or 2 days or 3 day period kind of thing. But, yeah. Well, I'm glad you saw that.
Yeah. And that was pretty much it out of the things that really could talk about.
And you sort of had your James Bond fix with Spy.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I did not see any new James Bond films.
So let's move on to Andre. What did you see recently?
I went out and I saw Jurassic World. I saw on Netflix Chappie and Black Hat.
Okay, interesting. This is stuff I think our fans would want to hear about. So let's start off with the oldest first. Wait, did Black Hat come out before or after Chappie?
It came out before.
Okay,
so January.
So tell us about Black Hat.
Okay, so I'm a huge fan of Michael Mann, as I've probably said before on the podcast and in the videos, and this one was really like a downer for me personally. It just was. You know, like, it seemed like it had a really good concept in terms of exploring cyber terrorism and the idea of Chris Hemsworth being like this former hacker that gets taken out of prison so he could go after the cyber terrorists with the FBI. But everything about it, I mean, they were trying to go for the collateral Miami Vice direction with the Viper cameras and trying to make it all very documentary looking. But it just was, it was way too long. It seemed like Michael Mann was finding every single excuse to get Chris Hemsworth out of his shirt. And I'm starting to also see flaws in Mann's style, where he tries so hard with his writing to have all his characters, especially Chris Hemsworth's character, to try to sound like the way Michael Mann speaks. If you ever heard him speak in an interview, it starts to come out more with all this philosophical talk, like, oh yeah, my life is hard and this is the way that I live my life by the rules of the code of the street or whatever the case may be. Yeah, it was just boring. It was just lazy direction. And, you know, for a movie that I thought probably would have benefited from the Sony hack and that controversy at the time, it was just a total letdown. And Viola Davis was also completely wasted in the film.
So you think it was just a job for hire on Michael Mann's part?
No, I think he was invested in the idea. I don't think it was like a paycheck job, but it was just the total execution of it. And maybe even casting Hemsworth just seemed like that. It seems like the case with a lot of his movies now, where he's going for just whoever's the flavor of the month, whether it's Colin Farrell in Miami Vice or Johnny Depp in Public Enemies. You know, like it was just.
To be fair, it may not be his fault. He may have no choice. Otherwise, he won't get his project greenlit.
That could be the case, but it just was, I look at something like, say, Thief or Heat or Collateral, where the story is simple enough you can follow it through and through. But when he gets into, like, stuff about the FBI and cyber terrorism, it's really hard to follow. And then there's all these things that go on that, like, Hemsworth is supposed to work with the Chinese, and there was this girl that I guess he was friends with her brother, and then he hooks up with the sister, and the brother's all pissed off. It just, then when you hammer in like the romantic element in Mann's movies, that's where it seems to start to fall into a lot of cracks.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen this yet, Jeff?
No, I actually have no interest in seeing it, especially now after hearing Andre's review of it. Mm.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like one of those things where it's like, I'll catch it when it's on cable.
Yeah.
You know? But, yeah. Anyway. So, moving on to Chappie.
You know, Chappie, here's the thing with Chappie. I actually enjoyed watching the movie. And I know a lot of people probably were shitting on it at the time it came out. You know, there were a lot of short circuit comparisons. And I think the movie also was drowned out by all the alien news with Neil Blomkamp. But, yeah, the short circuit references are definitely strong in this movie. You do have a case of this robot that finds humanity with an artificial intelligence chip. And, wants to survive, and you basically have Deb Pavel playing the Steve Guttenberg part, and you have Hugh Jackman playing the G.W. Bailey part, and Sigourney Weaver, who really doesn't do a whole lot in the movie. She's like the one who's running this program of putting robots on the streets of South Africa to put down crime, and it's working. And it's like Hugh Jackman, he's got like his big ass drone that he wants on the street, but the police think it's like total overkill.
So basically you got this RoboCop thing going on.
Yeah, a little bit of RoboCop and a little bit of Short Circuit. It just, you know, like, I guess I enjoyed it for the visuals. The action sequences were pretty cool. And, you know, and I did like the Chappie character overall. It wasn't like, yeah, maybe it was a little racist at times. He's speaking in all this street slang, and the gang that takes him in, they're kind of like become like his unofficial family. And, you know, they make
the Antford.
Yeah.
they got the most criticism in this film. A lot of people said they were so annoying. Did you feel that way?
You know, that's the thing. Like, I don't think their acting was great, but it didn't fall into certain cliches once it got to the end of the movie. Like, there's certain characters you think are going to survive and end up getting killed. Or, there's another big twist that happens that I think might be polarizing for some audiences, so I'm not going to spoil it. But there's a lot of changes that some of these characters go through that I thought was kind of interesting. Yeah, overall, I didn't hate it. I mean, I still think District 9 is his best film, and then maybe after that, Elysium was a little better than this. But, you know, this wasn't all that bad. It just was like Blomkamp needs to mix it up a bit now, because to continue to do the South African sci-fi stories, yeah, it's just starting to get a little bit stale, but not terrible. Like, he still has hope.
Were you too distracted by Hugh Jackman's mullet?
No, you know, if anything, I thought he had fun doing the movie. Like, I think he thrived in playing the villain this go around. And
I know from clips I've seen, he looks like the what's his name who plays the prison guard in Orange Is the New Black.
Yeah, he's a little weird in the sense that he's like this hardcore military guy, but then he's also very religious at the same time. And every time, like, you see him, like, hiding at times in his office or, like, in the storage area where they build all the machines, and he's overhearing Dev Pavel trying to, like, save Chappie when his battery life is going down, or that he discovers that he has artificial intelligence, and all of a sudden, like, he starts praying to himself.
All right. I'm sorry, you haven't really sold me on this film.
It's a mixed bag, but like I said, it's not terrible. I think it just, once you get past the short circuit comparisons, it's actually tolerable.
Okay, all right. And then Jurassic World, really curious to hear what you have to say about this.
Okay, so the best way I could put it now, there's a lot of people that really love this movie. I'm going to just get into the pros and cons because, honestly, I left the theater very mixed on my opinion. On the positive side, it is the best of all the sequels. It definitely shows you the whole vision of the world that John Hammond had wanted in his mind since the original. You have a lot of nostalgic references that I thought were very well done. They have the original score in there at times. And there's maybe like subtle references to Ian Malcolm and to, you know, the events that took place in the original film and how, like, you know, oh, you know, we got everything covered because we're safer. And, you know, now we got sponsors that are naming the dinosaurs and, you know, attendance up every time we create a new one. So they were a little inventive in that. And then, you know, all hell breaks loose with this big ass T-Rex. And Chris Pratt was really good. I mean, he was definitely a charismatic hero. Not far different from Star-Lord, but, you know, a little bit of a different shade. He was enjoyable to watch. And one character I really liked, I don't know the actor's name, but they had, like, all these cutscenes to the control room when the park starts going loose. And they have this one guy who's, like, he's a total Jurassic Park geek. Like, he bought, like, an old Jurassic Park chair from eBay. And, you know, he talked about how, like, in the old days, the John Hammond Park had, like, real dinosaurs. And this is just, like, total hybrids and just artificial bullshit. He was almost, like, speaking like one of these fanboy geeks that just is in love with whatever's original and then just can't stand anything that's rebooted or remade. And Colin Trevorrow, I think he did a good job in terms of the humor, because the humor actually works in this film. Again, like a lot of moments where you think it's going to get a little cliched and it doesn't. So those are aspects I like. Now, the flaws that I felt this film had, there were just a number of undeveloped characters that I felt just, they made the film a little too awkward for me. Like, you have this Indian guy, I'm trying to remember his name here, Irfan Khan. He was in Amazing Spider-Man. He was like one of the Oscorp employees. He plays a guy that's actually owning the Jurassic World park, and supposedly, like, his character inherited the park from John Hammond, but the way he comes across, he's like this almost arrogant rich guy who loves flying his planes and helicopters and tries to be all adventurous. I just didn't see him as somebody that John Hammond would believably give this park to. He just seemed like a whole different version of the lawyer from the first movie. It's like, how can you even trust this guy to run your damn park after you're dead? And then there was also, like, the subplot with Bryce Dallas Howard's two nephews, and there was, like, the whole thing where, like, she doesn't spend any time with them because she's so work-oriented. The younger brother is played by the kid from Iron Man 3, the one that played the Harley character. But then you had the older brother, who I could not stand because he's supposed to be, like, the one who's, like, too cool for school. He's, like, all into girls, and the whole time he's in the park, he's just checking out all the chicks. And, you know, he's just, like, such a weird character because, on one hand, he's not into anything that's going on. He thinks the park is for kids. But then the next minute, without any explanation, like, all of a sudden, now he's trying to be all brotherly to his brother and be like, oh, I'm going to just go and show you something really cool. And then they go into, like, the this open observatory, and that's when the Indominus Rex attacks them in the trailer. Just, like, a very undeveloped character, and I just didn't understand. And everybody's fucking posing like they're models. Like, every time you see Chris Pratt, like, he's just standing around. Like, when he gets out of the elevator or goes into an elevator, he's standing there in, like, a superhero pose. It just was like, are you guys trying to be, like, in panic mode? Or are you trying to, like, pose for the camera? I mean, come on.
I find the criticisms of the film, well, they're always more interesting because they tend to be the more entertaining takes on the film. But yeah, it seems to me that the people who've been criticizing it, that they mentioned that there's a lot of, like, unexplained things that happen in the film where suddenly there's a character, there's a plot point involving a character, something about a character that suddenly shows up conveniently so they can do that plot point or something like that.
Yeah.
That wasn't explained before. And I think it was Devin Faraci on Birth Movies Death, which used to be called Badass Digest. He did a whole article about how mean-spirited Jurassic World is, where the characters are not only unnecessarily killed off, but in very unnecessarily gratuitous ways.
Yeah, they try to go for... I mean, the shock value in this is probably tame in comparison to Jurassic Park. It's not as violent as the first movie was. And, like, the chemistry with Chris Pratt and Bryce Dallas Howard, it definitely comes across as very Hawksian. Like, there's a lot of this banter between them and, like, you know, I'm a man, so you should just stand back and let me do my job. I know there was that whole criticism that occurred, and they really do play that up in the movie, like in the scenes that are not in the trailer. But one area where I think it did work and I find ironic was the fact that, you know, the criticism that I think the previous sequels had was that they just weren't innovative enough. Like, yeah, you know, as you kept advancing CG, you know, the first movie was just such an amazing thing to watch. But after that, it's like, okay, we've seen this before. What else are you going to possibly do? New dinosaurs, a bigger T-Rex. What's there to be excited about now? And they do play that up in the film where it's like this park has been open for so many years already. And, you know, it's like they have to keep trying to make the dinosaurs bigger and more unique and combine them with all kinds of different animals. And they really play that up in the sense of, like, how big is too big? And then when everything goes wrong, it's like, well, you know, we're just, like, completely dropping the ball here. And maybe we shouldn't be messing around with this science that really shouldn't have been messed around with in the first place. So I think it really was addressing, like, breaking the fourth wall in addressing those concerns. And at the same time, this one felt more like a Michael Crichton story than the previous movies because of the fact that the park is already there. So it's like Westworld where everything just goes wrong even after everybody thinks, oh, this is a great park. It's got all this attendance. And then shit happens. Everybody goes crazy.
You mentioned nothing innovative enough. How was the whole stuff with the friendly raptors?
You know, that whole scene, which, like, I guess was like the big money shot, it didn't last as long as it looked on the trailers. Although they do play up the raptor control aspect of the story. And there's maybe like something of a nice payoff at the end. But don't be surprised if you think that's going to be a whole long, amazing sequence.
All right. Okay. Anything else?
No, that's about it. I mean, I still think it's worth seeing in the theater. But you know, just don't be totally overhyped about it.
Well, what I'm fascinated about is the director, how he started off doing that one indie film that was really good, Safety Not Guaranteed, and on his second film, and now he has the second highest opening weekend movie, you know, of all time. So it's like, where do you go next if you don't do a sequel to this?
He's either going to do a Star Wars movie or a Marvel film. That's what I picture.
Yeah, probably. Probably. Anyway, so I guess it's my turn, huh? Well, besides Spy, I have two flicks on my list. I'll start with the oldest one first. Bit of a cult classic of this film, Pet Sematary.
Ah.
I had seen it in a while, decided to revisit it recently. Doesn't hold up.
Big shock.
It's a weird film in that its staying power is in its unintentional camp. It's a campy film, but I don't think they intended that. It's a really terribly acted movie.
Well, Dale Midkiff is not the most...
He's awful.
...appealing leading man.
Oh, my God, he's awful. But the thing is, either an actor is, like, sleepwalking throughout the entire film, like Dale Midkiff, or they turn up the volume on being incredibly pissed all the fucking time, like Denise Crosby, who plays his wife. And there's no nuance. I mean, even Fred Gwynne, a.k.a. Herman Munster, right?
Mm-hmm.
His role is so cliche. To the point where I, like, tuned out and just found myself fixated on his hearing aid when I realized the character had a hearing aid on.
You didn't like his accent, or his New England accent?
It's just this, like, really weird thing. It's like, okay, why did you take this guy to the Pet Sematary in the first place? If you felt that that's something that no one should mess with? You know, it's like really weird stuff. And because the performance is so bad, you don't really give a shit. I thought the little kid was annoying as hell.
Oh, God, yeah.
And I thought, like, the reactions to things were just didn't make sense. It was, I don't know. It's not a boring movie. Let's put it that way. You definitely derive some sort of entertainment watching it. But there's been this, like, there is a following behind Pet Sematary, and I just don't understand it. Folks, it's not a good movie. It's not. And Mary Lambert, who directed it, she's done nothing else, really.
She did the second one, right?
She did the second one, which was horrible.
Oh, I saw that one in theaters.
A bunch of music videos, and I think that's it.
I think she's done another film, but probably not anything of note.
Yeah, I haven't seen Pet Sematary.
I'm going to look her up.
Yeah, I looked her up after I watched Pet Sematary. I was like, Mary Lambert. She's known for something else. Because, you know, I thought at the time, well, she's kind of like the Catherine Bigelow of that time. Kind of thing, you know, because Bigelow was doing Near Dark and other films, you know, before she hit it big later on. And I thought, well, maybe Lambert had a similar career that early. But no, I looked her up. It's like, wow, surprise. She hadn't really done that much. She just did the two Pet Sematary movies and maybe something else, and she was known for some of her music videos.
Oh, yeah, because the only other thing I'm seeing is one of the Urban Legend sequels.
Oh,
There you go. So, anyway... Pet Sematary, kind of awful. And I watched a Swedish language film called Sound of Noise.
I've heard of that. I'd never seen it, though.
Really interesting film. It's, how do I describe it? It's sort of a black comedy musical.
Okay.
It's about a group of anarchists who are percussionists. And their terrorist acts are built around... they're kind of like a flash mob kind of thing, where they go into a certain environment and they take over that environment and they use everything as a musical instrument. So it's like it's almost like the anti what are those movies? The Step Up movies, whatever. It's kind of like that, but funny and satirical. And I think it was a Swedish, French co-production. But I liked it. I liked it a lot, actually. I thought it was really, really cool and very creatively done. And you have this really interesting main character who's like the police detective who's like on their hot on their tail, right? And that could have been a cliche in itself, but turns out that he's a member of a family that are famous musicians and composers and conductors. And he's the only member of the family that's tone deaf. And that plays into his like trying to like solve this mystery a lot. And it's interesting the character arc he has throughout. I recommend it. You can stream it on Netflix, folks.
Sounds like it would be up Channing Tatum's alley now with his love for comedy.
You know, the immediate thing that hit me was like, would this be ripe for an American remake? How would they do it and who would be in it? And I'm not sure, because part of what's charming about the film is everyone is kind of an asshole, but in the sense that they're all kind of like outcasts and they're not pretty, you know, they're nerdy and, you know, they're all very quirky and unusual and weird. I don't know how they would remake that for the American market, but they say went for a Channing Tatum type who would be totally wrong.
Mark Duplass?
Actually, Mark Duplass would be a great American counterpart to the detective character. Absolutely. He would be. Because that character is almost the main character of the movie. Because he's kind of like nerdy. And he's kind of like, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? He's not outgoing. Let's put it that way. and it's interesting how, like, although he's tone deaf, he does have a knowledge of music, etc., because of his upbringing and all that. But I recommend it. I thought it was cool. And that's it. That's all I have to say. Those are the two films I saw recently. No, actually, that's not true. We rewatched Adam's Family and Adam's Family's Values.
Yeah. I like the sequel.
Yeah, I like the sequel better.
Yeah, the sequel's hilarious. It's actually very, very funny. They're kind of disjointed. You could tell, like, okay, let's come up with a lot of Adam's Family vignettes and try to force a plot onto it. But the second one, it works better. And Joan Cusack is very amusing in it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, so moving on to news. And there's been a lot of news since we've last recorded this podcast. I'm just going to start off probably with what I consider to be the most important news that broke, the death of Christopher Lee,
yeah.
Sir Christopher Lee. Man, oh man, did that guy have a long career. He was going strong right up until the bitter end.
Man,
and more power to him.
Yeah.
Can you think of any favorite Christopher Lee roles?
The first one for me, like my introduction to him was Gremlins 2, The New Batch. And I didn't know anything about him playing Dracula or playing a Bond villain or anything like that. But even in that movie, he was just scary as hell. And looking like he reminded me of the guy from the Phantasm movies when I saw him. But then seeing him after that, like playing Scaramanga, Man with the Golden Gun, and being in Star Wars, Lord of Rings, and list goes on and on. I mean, he really... God bless the guy. I mean, he lived life to the fullest as an actor and as a person. I mean, having a heavy metal album in your 90s, that's badass. So
he had two metal albums. He actually put out three albums, two of which were heavy metal.
Yeah. He just kicked ass. He's going to be missed.
Yeah. Yeah. It's well, I was recently a guest on a new podcast. You all know Token Tom Clark. He started a new podcast, and it's fun. It was a fun podcast to be on, actually. It's called the Necrocasticon, and I was part of a segment where we just discussed Christopher Lee, and they brought up the record albums, and so I looked them up. You have to look at the record album cover art for his first album. It's hilarious. It's absolutely hilarious. I'm trying to look it up right now so I can give you guys the title. But it's like the worst photoshopping you've ever seen in your entire life. But here we go. The album's called Revelation. just, if you got access to the internet, guys, look this up. It's hilarious. And then you compare that to the two heavy metal albums. It was like a two-part album. They're both called Charlemagne. That album art is badass.
Oh my god, I'm just looking at Christopher Lee Revelation album cover now.
Right?
Oh man.
It's so bad. It's so bad. But look at the two album cover arts for the Charlemagne albums.
Oh jeez.
They're awesome. They're so awesome. Anyway, we wax on a lot about his roles, and that this guy played Dracula, not just for Hammer, but for other film companies as well. He played the Mummy. Mm-hmm. He played the Frankenstein monster. He played Sherlock Holmes, and he played Sherlock Holmes' brother,
Mycroft.
Right. This guy did everything. Short of playing the kitchen sink, you know? I would say my favorite Christopher Lee role is definitely The Wicker Man.
I would agree there, because unfortunately, I was introduced to him through The Howling 2.
Yeah, right. He was in Howling 2. That's right.
And I wouldn't look for him, but he'd always pop up in, like, many films. Like, later in life, he also popped up in a lot of Tim Burton movies and cameo roles. In fact, he's one of the better things in that remake of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, playing Willy Wonka's father.
Yeah, I agree with that. And Tim Burton wrote a wonderful elegy for Christopher Lee recently, which is online. Everyone can read it. I would Google it, check it out. But yeah, he did that. God, he did so many things.
He was Ian Fleming's cousin.
He was Ian Fleming's cousin. He himself worked for the British Secret Service during World War II. He was an SAS officer, or he was a part of what was originally the SAS. He saw a lot of action. He was fluent in several languages, including languages that are now dead. This guy was pretty crazy talented and quite brilliant as an individual. And I mentioned this in the podcast, I guess it on. I heard this anecdote about him, which I thought was amusing. He had a reputation for being quite the gentleman and all that stuff. But there was some Hammer makeup artist made some comment about how vain Christopher Lee was. He was so vain, because Christopher Lee wore a hairpiece throughout his entire life, right? He was so vain that he insisted on wearing his hairpiece underneath the mummy makeup. I mean, he's covered in bandages, right? So anyway, but having said that, I adore Christopher Lee. Rest in peace, but I applaud you and your career. Rock on. So moving on from Christopher Lee. This is sort of movie related, but it was very amusing to me. And before we get off on Christopher Lee, did you guys see that thing I posted on my Facebook page?
I don't think so.
If you can find it, check it out. He was in a movie called Return of Captain Invincible. It's a musical kind of in the mode of Rocky Horror, but deals with a superhero who was blacklisted during the 1950s because he wore a red cape. And Alan Arkin plays that superhero. He becomes an alcoholic and is discovered washed up in Australia. And he's asked to come back to service because Christopher Lee is this evil mastermind. And Christopher Lee has this, like, crazy, insane musical sequence where he sings about basically trying to tempt the superhero back to drinking again. And his song's called Know Your Poison. And I posted it on my Facebook page, so I encourage you all to check that out. It's you'll just sit there and go, what the fuck am I looking at? Christopher Lee singing about cocktails, ladies and gentlemen. Cocktails.
Nice.
Anyway, so what I was going to say is Arnold Schwarzenegger has been putting out these videos to promote his charity, After School All-Stars. Have you seen his recent one?
Where
he plays practical jokes on the public? The first video had him at a gym, at Gold's Gym, with like a long hair and ponytail and a Fu Manchu mustache, just going around giving people like workout advice, right? And people like looking at him as like, is that Arnold Schwarzenegger? You know, kind of thing. The new one that just went online about a couple of days ago is him in his complete Terminator outfit, hanging out in Hollywood's Madame Tussauds, right? Mm-hmm. And people will go around him and get their photograph taken. Suddenly he comes to life. And it's pretty funny. There's a scene where he's wandering around through the Hollywood Walk of Fame with one of those, GoPro cameras stuck to a selfie stick. and in Terminator mode, he's like, "You knocked into my selfie stick." You know, things like that. So you should check that out. It's actually pretty funny. Schwarzenegger getting really goofy in his old age, and I kind of love it. So we got two, not one, but two Bermuda Triangle-themed movies in production. One by Universal, another one by Skydance.
Sounds like the Dante's Peak and Volcano of the modern age.
But what's the premise here? They go to the area that's a triangle and they disappear?
Well, maybe it's what's beyond the triangle, so it's sort of like a Tomorrowland type of thing.
Oh, no.
Maybe. Maybe not. Remember there was a TV series in the 70s where a yachting expedition or something like that goes into the Bermuda Triangle, and it was like sort of like a, I don't know, it was like one of these series where each episode was them like being confronted with a different adventure and stuff like that.
Fantasy Island.
It was kind of like a Fantasy Island kind of premise, yeah. Yeah, well, there you go. So anyways, all you Bermuda Triangle fans out there, you have a lot to look forward to.
Or you could call it Gilligan's Island, the prequel.
Right. By the way, who goes on a three-hour tour?
Yeah, that's kind of bullshit.
Was it popular back then? I don't know.
Like what is it that you can possibly tour in 3 hours?
Maybe there were a bunch of different islands they wanted to see.
And what is a millionaire, a movie star, and a professor doing on that fucking tour?
They all have their different reasons. And
all right.
It's like Lost. Or there's that fantasy novel you can write about
Somebody's
how they got
the
there.
No, Jeff, it's like if they remade it today, you're the guy who is assisting, I don't know, Michael Fultz's cheap little rinky-dinky Circle Line business, where you help him like do the, you know, this like water taxi around Manhattan Island, and it just so happens that the three people that decide to take that tour that day are Donald Trump, The Rock, and I don't know, name a famous scientist.
Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yeah, right. I mean, I don't think about that for a second, folks. Okay, so moving on from that, we have, they've greenlit, it was one of these blacklist screenplays, Passengers. Sci-fi thing. It's described as Gravity, but with a romance element. Apparently Chris Pratt and Jennifer Lawrence are attached. And Morton Tilden, who directed Headhunters. Did you guys see Headhunters?
Yes.
No.
Okay, he's going to be directing this. And I find it interesting, not because I care about the film or who's cast in it or who's directing it, but apparently Jennifer Lawrence is getting $20 million for this, with a 30% against a 30% take off the profits. And Chris Pratt is now getting $12 million for it, thanks to his status now as having just starred in one of the most successful movies of all time. And this is going to tie into our conversation later about how this fuels the Hollywood economy. But I find that kind of interesting.
Good for them.
Well, yeah, I'm interested in the film. So, and I mean, now it's going to be much more high profile.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes. Apparently, Kenneth Branagh is in talks to direct Murder on the Orient Express, a new version.
Of course he
would. The Agatha Christie novel, which was originally filmed by Sidney Lumet, right? Starred Albert Finney as Hercule Poirot. It was made for TV later on with Alfred Molina as Poirot. I'm kind of interested in this. I'm an Agatha Christie nerd. Murder on the Orient Express is such a weird mystery for her, though. It has probably the strangest reveal out of any mystery there ever was. And it's almost a cop-out reveal. And I'm going to explain what that is, folks. Spoiler. You may want to fast-forward about, 5 minutes after this, in case you haven't seen the original Murder on the Orient Express, but I really want to talk about this. But how odd that you end your movie with the reveal that Well, either the killer jumped off the train sometime back, or everybody did it.
And then they show us everybody doing it.
Yes.
So, yeah. But I like Lumet's movie. It's kind of different. It's kind of out of his comfort zone.
I just remember Sean Connery being in it.
Yeah, Sean Connery basically plays, you know, like if you ever play a Clue, he's like the colonel, you know. He's an archetype in that. Everyone's sort of like Michael York is in it.
Vanessa Redgrave.
Vanessa Redgrave.
Isn't Ingrid Bergman in it?
Yes, she is. That is correct. That is correct. Richard Widmark is the victim.
As always.
Right. It's a classy movie. It's a classy. I think Finney's performance is a little weird.
I thought you were going to say over the top.
It's over the top, but it's weird. He does all these weird, eccentric things with the character, and you're just like, why are you doing that? But you know who's played Hercule Poirot? Because he's been on screen a lot. I mean, the most famous recent rendition was by David Suchet, right?
Yes.
The TV series Poirot, which is a very good TV series. But Tony Randall played him.
I wouldn't want to.
In the 1960s. It's a cute film. It's actually a very watchable movie. It's called The ABC Murders. And then you had Peter Ustinov played him for a while in a series of movies. And I already mentioned Alfred Molina. So yeah, I'm keeping my eye on that. I'm curious to see where they go with that. I'd be more interested. Say again.
Oh no, I was gonna say as long as it's better than his remake of Sleuth.
Yeah, that's the only thing. I would like to see someone take another stab at And Then There Were None, or Ten Little Indians, whatever you want to call it. But let's see what they do with Murder on the Orient Express.
They should just cast a whole movie with all the Downton Abbey cast members.
Well, I hope they don't modern it up. I would love to see them set it in the 20s, make it really classy. I could see them like throwing Maggie Smith in there because you know at one time we had gratuitous sex and violence. Now we have gratuitous Maggie Smith. So anyway, moving on, just completely in the opposite direction. This had been long in a pipeline be turned into a movie. This was like a popular novel. I think it was a popular digital novel. Sort of mutant shark story called Meg is finally being turned into a movie directed by Eli Roth. Sounds
of
like
course.
It's Jaws 2.0. We'll see what happens there. Anyone, any thoughts? Do you guys care?
I got nothing.
I'll wait to see the trailer.
Speaking of horror hot has-beens, we're getting another Halloween.
Oh, yes.
Halloween Returns.
And isn't this just a direct sequel to part one and two of the original?
No, I think they're rebooting it.
Oh, okay.
They're pretending the Rob Zombie ones didn't happen. Oh, you mean the original? You mean the actual?
Yeah,
the John Carpenter. I believe so, yeah.
Okay.
I believe you're correct.
Just
about
do
that.
A sequel to Halloween 3. Halloween 3 Part 2.
Yeah, I'd like to know more about the Shamrock Mask Company and all that stuff.
Yeah. Just a little conspiracy.
Yeah, I'd like to see more. I think there's like other stories to be told there. So, moving on, we're getting a Maleficent sequel. Too bad Mr. Foltz isn't with us to give us his thoughts on that. I know he'd be scoffing at the prospect, but there you go. I guess the public demanded it, so we're getting one.
Yeah, I'll skip.
All right. And here we go. We talked about this recently. The Crow remake. Jack Huston has left.
This project is just cursed. Maybe nobody wants to get shot on this set. That's why they're having so many problems.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe there is that curse that's just making it so difficult for them to get this off the ground. Who knows? I mean, it got sequels.
But what can you do that's different in a remake or reboot that hasn't been done? I mean, every movie is just somebody dying, they come back, and then they get revenge on all their killers. It's like, what are you going to do that's different? Put it in the future?
Well, the thing about The Crow was it was a comic book property. The appeal to The Crow was the whole goth rock vibe to it. So if you remake it, without retaining those aspects, yeah, there isn't really any point to it. Because all you got is a story that's been done over and over and over again, right? It's High Plains Drifter, but in a goth rock environment.
Right.
Yeah, and it's interesting that, especially Jack Houston, this would be his first really major starring role. And for him to just all of a sudden just walk away weeks before filming, there has to be something seriously wrong with the project.
Yeah, who knows?
Maybe it'll be the Joel Kinnaman next.
What about Clint Howard? Okay,
I'm
so
always free.
He was in Evil Speak.
He's always free.
So since we got a lot to go through and a large discussion to have, let's move on to the next item. It turns out that Hateful Eight, the next Quentin Tarantino film, is going to get an early release, early limited release, in films that are equipped to project 70 millimeter.
Should be fun.
I'll check that out. I read the script. I read that script that was released. And it sounds like what he's doing isn't that different than what I read. And I'm looking forward to it. I think it's very, it starts off in a way you think you know where it's going. It becomes something kind of cool. You think it's going to be this epic Western, right? And then it becomes Quentin Tarantino's Agatha Christie piece. it becomes a chamber room mystery. And I thought that was really, really awesome. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. What else? Oh, this I was kind of, I want to bring this up only because I am a fan of the comic book property, and I think this was a perfect casting choice. John Bernthal is going to be the Punisher in season 2 of Daredevil.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Mm.
That's inspired.
It's a great choice.
It's a very good choice. Very good choice. Bring it on.
I think it'll set up a really good potential spinoff series, because I think that with the way they set up Daredevil and the tone that they got, it's going to be the right way to go versus what they've had in the past with the Punisher. So I'm looking forward to this.
Now, the question remains is who's going to play Bullseye? Because originally they had talked about Jason Statham doing it, but because the word got out there too much, he decided to raise his paycheck and decided not to use him anymore, from what I understand. Because that would have been inspired casting, too.
True.
That would have been really cool if, like, they announced a Bullseye as a villain, you didn't know who it was, and then it was Jason Statham, you know?
I could see Woody Harrelson.
You know what? I think that could work. I think that's
that could be fun.
Yeah, I think that could be fun. Why not? Interesting choice. I like the way you think, Andre Joseph.
Yes, listen to me, Marvel. You gotta hire me.
Yeah. That will be the day.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's quickly get through the trailers that have been released. We had a new trailer for Spectre, television trailer. It gave us a little bit more about the movie. Still not enough to have an opinion on it. But you get to hear him say Bond, James Bond, as he attempts to seduce, what's her name?
Oh, Monica Bellucci.
Monica Bellucci, the oldest Bond girl now. Yeah, I have nothing really to say about it other than that.
You go skiing.
You go skiing.
At least it's not CGI skiing.
So, we had a trailer for this interesting-looking film by Alejandro Amendabar, who directed the others, called The Repression, with Ethan Hawke. Have you seen the trailer for that yet?
I haven't.
No.
I think it deals with satanic cults or something.
The new flavor of the month?
So, yeah, Ethan Hawke's like a police detective investigator, and it stumbles onto this conspiracy kind of thing. Has what's-her-name, who was in the Harry Potter films.
Emma Watson?
Emma Watson, she's in it, with an American accent.
Okay, that interests me. Now all it needs is a computer, and I'm there.
Yeah! and cannibalistic pigs.
Exactly.
We've got Mockingbird Part 2 trailer was released since we last podcast. The finale to the Hunger Games franchise.
Yes, happily.
I'm meh on it.
I'm not a fan.
I'll probably watch it on cable.
All right. And finally, the Peanuts trailer. CGI Peanuts movie.
It looks cute. I'm not going to bash it because I've watched Peanuts as a kid.
I watched Peanuts too. To me, I'm sorry. I guess I just like the classic and keep it that way. Mm.
I do too. I have to say, looking at the trailer though, I think it's interesting how they approach the animation. Yeah, it's CGI, but at the same time, it's like they're doing a, you know, they're simulating a frame rate of like 12 frames per second animation. So it has that kind of feel of the classic Peanuts cartoons, even though everyone looks more three-dimensional and not 2D animation. I'm still annoyed by this trend in like kiddie films where they have to throw out all these pop music tropes.
Yeah.
You know, I just find it kind of that was kind of annoying me a little bit watching the trailer, but that's just my little nitpick, my little thing.
I remember in the 90s, John Hughes was going to do a Peanuts movie, and I don't know how that was going to turn out. He was, like, working with Charles Schultz on the script.
I wonder why no one's attempted to make a movie version of You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, because that would make a great movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a good story.
And it's a decent musical, and it's funny. And you can do it live action. You can do it with actual actors playing the parts. I don't know why they never went there. But anyway... So I guess that's it for trailers, unless you guys notice I forgot something.
Did you guys see the Cicero trailer?
Oh, that's right, the Cicero trailer. That looks interesting.
Yeah, I'm happy to see Emily Blunt in it, trying to be a badass.
Yeah, that looks kind of interesting. Yeah, sorry, I forgot to mention that one. Have you seen that trailer yet, Andre?
No, I think I saw a screenshot, but I didn't actually watch it.
Well, it deals with a computer, and it deals with cannibalistic pigs. All right, so, I guess we'll take our break to promote the other content on This Is Infamous, and when we come back, we're going to discuss the history of Hollywood economics, the current state of the industry, how things are different now versus then. It should be an interesting... potentially controversial conversation. Oh, somehow I don't think it will be. I think we'll all be on the same page, but you never know. So anyways, let's take a break, and when we'll come back, that's what we'll talk about. Oh, before we do that, please, please, please check us out on Twitter, follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, and join our Facebook group. We've got a lot going on there, and check out our CineFiles blog. That's cinefilestv.blogspot.com. Jeffrey is keeping that alive. He's doing a bang-up job at the same time. And that's basically it. So let's move on to the promos, and then we'll talk about Hollywood businesses.
Be sure to listen to the Screenshots Movie Podcast at the beginning of every week here on the This Is Infamous Radio Network as Billy Donnelly and Brian McKevitt break down and discuss all the latest happenings in the movie world. Check it out at thisisinfamous.com as well as on iTunes and Stitcher.
Kablam!
Tired of the same boring interviews where the same questions are asked of the same people over and over and over again? Then it's time for real interviews. For real. This conversational podcast will bring you some insight into Hollywood's best and brightest. Real interviews. For real. It's not the same old stuff.
We're going to focus on the Hollywood industry. This is inspired by a Facebook topic that exists in our Facebook group. If you haven't joined, what's wrong with you? But do so, and you can check it out. It was in response to an article where William Friedkin was quoted as basically saying, paraphrasing this, but saying that the superhero movies are basically ruining Hollywood. They're changing the quality of the content that's out there and all that stuff. And that in itself inspired a lot of like strong responses. And one of the specific responses against what Friedkin was saying by some of the fans was like, I don't understand why people are harshing on superhero films and blaming them for the state of Hollywood and all that stuff. They're just another genre, just like the Western or the film noir or horror, something like that. And so that I thought that would be a good starting point for this particular discussion, and just getting into the differences between how the business works in film production today and distribution versus how it used to work earlier than 1975, right? Because 1975, 1976, 1977, in that two-year period, you had two films come out, Jaws and Star Wars, and they changed how we approach not only making films, but distributing films. And some other factors come into play here as well. That happened around the late 60s, early 70s that we have to get into. But what are you guys' thoughts on this?
Well, obviously, you know, I find it interesting that two movies in particular helped create this revolution, whereas I guess it seems to have stayed the same or even gotten worse in a certain sense, rather than like today we follow trends, but nothing seems to stay, I guess, the same.
Right.
Like my thing is, like, now it's gotten worse to me because it seems like you can only make two types of films. It has to be a movie that seems to cost over $100 million, or it has to be like down indie, like under $10 million. Like, there's no more mid-range real budget films anymore, unless it's like really maybe a star vehicle.
Right. Although last year, Universal kind of disproved that point, where they made a lot of mid-range budget of films, and they had a profit. They announced a profit at the end of that year because of it. Their biggest production was Dracula Untold, and that was like $75 million or something like that, which isn't big.
Yeah, but see, I guess my thing is, to me, it would make more sense to double down on the mid-range films rather than, it seems like, a gambling problem where you're like, I'm going for all or nothing. And
The opposite end of that spectrum, you have Blumhouse, which has been getting a lot of press lately for their business model, where they have a set budget per film, per title, and they just allow any director to do what they want within that budget. But because they have a production deal with, I think it's Paramount? I can't remember. I have to look it up. But they're tied into what they're willing to distribute. And so you have a whole bunch of these films that are made by Blumhouse that never get released, not even get VOD release. They're just kind of sitting there and collecting digital dust. But they pride themselves in their model and that they're always going to make a profit because they're maintaining this budget. But the problem is all the advertising has to come from the distributor, which is the major studio that they have this deal with. And they're the ones who are like, well, I'm not sure I want to put in this much effort advertising this particular film when it doesn't have the audience, right? And that ties in with that famous speech Steven Soderbergh gave. Did you guys follow that?
I remember reading it, yeah.
And you can go it online. It was actually posted to that conversation thread in our Facebook group where he describes basically the nuts and bolts of the business, the state of the industry today, what might be wrong with it, the idea that you put so much money into the production of the film, then you put a lot of money into the promotion of that film, and then for some reason, like, even though everybody, including their dead ancestors, know this film is coming out, right? Like a Batman film or something like that. For some reason, the studio still insists on saturating the market with advertisement the two or three days leading up to it when they don't really need to do it, which also increases the budget, the P&L, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And going back to what I was mentioned in the news segment about the casting of Chris Pratt and Jennifer Lawrence in this new science fiction film, Passengers, and their particular price tag, that's something there that's an example of the difference between Hollywood today and Hollywood yesterday. People forget that pre-1970, everything was a contract system.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that when you did a film for, say, Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer or Universal, right, you were an employee of that studio. Your contract was not per film. It was an agreement to make a minimum amount of movies within the year or 2 year of that contract. So it's like if you're working in a store like Walmart, you're their employee. So that means some days you're going to stock the shelves. Some days you're going to be on register. Some days you're going to be at the information booth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas today, everyone's a free agent. So it's like say Anthony Mann wanted to make a Western starring Jimmy Stewart, right? The studio waived the contract in front of Jimmy Stewart and remind him you're contractually obligated to be in this movie. This is, you know, whatever. He would have to do it. Whereas today, you want to get Robert Downey Jr., he's going to negotiate a really high fee if you want him to be in your movie, because why else would he want to do a role that's only interesting when he has lines, when the majority of the film is just a CGI version of him or a stuntman in an armor costume? And he has to commit to promoting the film through press conferences and Comic-Cons just before the film's released, right?
Well, yeah, and don't forget, I'm sure his perks, like he'll decide, oh, I want this part rewritten in a certain way.
So the comparison of, so the argument that you shouldn't harsh on superhero films, they're just another genre like everything else, I find that befuddling. Because once the contract system dissipated in the early 1970s, those studios didn't make Westerns because, oh, there are Western fans out there. There's a market for Westerns, right? That was part of it, but they made it because they needed a portfolio of movies. You know, when you would go to the movies in those days, all you had competing against it might have been television. Television was reasonably new. Oh, and yeah. Radio, mm-hmm. Right? So what would people do with their free time? They would spend it all day in a movie theater. So they would hand over their 5 cents, whatever it costs in those days, and it would see like one film after another, and it would be a Western, it would be a romance, it might be a film noir, whatever.
Like going to a film festival.
Right, kind of like that. But because they had nothing better to do. You know? It was a cheap way to get away from things. And today, it's not a cheap way to get away from things, one. Two, we're oversaturated with content. I mean, why would we go to the movie theater, spend $15 and an additional $20 in concessions when we can watch everything we need to watch on our smart TVs, our smartphones, our iPads, our computers, our personal PCs, you know, that whole nine yards. So Hollywood has to really, really push to get people in the seats of those cinemas. Hence, these things become amusement park rides, which doesn't necessarily translate into being a good movie, one. And two, it's all about branding.
Well, that's the thing, too. And this actually, it ties into something that George Lucas had once said. Or actually, let me backtrack. Gary Kurtz, he produced Star Wars, he produced The Empire Strikes Back. And I remember specifically he was interviewed about the direction that the Star Wars films were going to take after Empire, most of which was going to be kind of like what they're doing now. They want to go back. It was going to be more darker. You know, things were going to be a little bit more doom and gloom as the story progressed. George Lucas felt because there were toys to be sold, there were kids watching these films, he felt, and this, I think it was particularly after Raiders of the Lost Ark came out, he felt like the audience only wanted the thrills, they wanted the effects, they wanted a good time at the theater. And that's why the later films became just that. They became thrill rides. They became effects heavy. The substance of the story and progression of the characters took the back seat. And I think if you look past superhero movies, the one constant that goes as far back as 75 with Jaws is that most of these films are designed to basically transport you into a whole different world, have this sit back and enjoy the ride mentality, and then you leave the ride, it's over, and you may want to go again. So I think it's not just about superhero movies. I think it's just, even something like, say, San Andreas, which is not even a tentpole movie, was able to be sold on big special effects, buildings crumbling, and The Rock saving people. People are going to go see it because it was marketed heavy, and it had eye candy. And that's what these studios do to make their money.
Well, but we have to, the thing we have to ask ourselves is why. I think we have to look back at how this all began, you know, in mid-70s.
Oh, yeah.
And it began because they realized there was a market during the summer months because people were out of school, right? Now, we don't realize this today, but the whole idea of a long summer vacation didn't exist until, you know, late 60s, early 70s. And therefore, to take advantage of this new demographic of kids and college students was something new to everybody. that these guys are out of school. Maybe they have a summer job or whatever, but that's a market to tap into. Let's fill the seats with those people. And what happened, you know, in the very beginning, you had Jaws, Star Wars. That kicked off the whole concept of the summer blockbuster, the summer season. That was followed by films like Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know, Black Hole, you know, all these films that came out to cash in on that experience. And as a result, the films became more and more geared and tailored towards that demographic. Thus, it became a tad more simplified as the years went on. There's another factor that we have to consider. And before I get into that, this is tied into that. I'm looking at domestic sales, ticket sales, starting from 1995 until 2015. Now, to be fair, the 2015 numbers don't appear to include Jurassic World, and that did pretty damn well, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
However, it was at its lowest ebb in 1995, all right, which is interesting. And then it peaked between 2001 and 2002. Right, which is interesting. This is just after 9/11, okay, and it started to decline steadily, and so thus far, and the year isn't over yet. It's at its lowest depth. This is the lowest year in ticket sales since 1995. Okay. Now, having said that, this market is still dominated by This year it was Jurassic World and the Avengers Age of Ultron so far.
Mm-hmm.
Last year was Guardians of the Galaxy. The year before that was Iron Man 3. The year before that was The Avengers. The year before that was Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part 2. Right? The year before that was Toy Story 3. The year before that was Transformers Revenge of the Fallen. The year before that was The Dark Knight. The year before that was Spider-Man 3. You see the pattern here. Okay, so this is the other aspect. We're looking at domestic sales. We got to talk about international sales.
Whole different story.
But that is the predominant factor in what drives big budget movie making these days. Because on top of the fact that you're trying to get the biggest largest demographic domestically, families, kids, college students, right? Internationally, you want that as well, because that's where you're going to get your biggest bang, and therefore the films are conceived to be the least translatable.
Yeah, visual. Mm-hmm. That's why this has been big.
And the easiest to understand. Therefore, less nuanced and what have you. You know, so that's where the market's gone. That's where we're at today. Coupled with how we become attention deficit disorder, with having technology at our fingertips, we're used to watching 3-second clips, you know, 30-second clips on even less on you know, YouTube, and until we get bored of that, move on to the next thing. Everything is everywhere, and that also adds to the budget because there's so many outlets now to promote and advertise that's going to feed into your budget again. In the old days, all you had was radio, maybe TV, when TV started to appear in everybody's homes in the late 1950s. The trailer before a movie would begin in a movie theater. And again, due to the advent of TV, maybe the occasional appearance on a talk show. Now you have websites. Now you have YouTube ads. Now you have mobile phone ads. Now you have a whole slew of trailers and advertisements you see before a movie begins. You know, you got all the stuff. You got ads appearing, you know, in Times Square on a big, you know, LCD TVs, you know, all that stuff.
Releasing footage like the first 5 minutes of a film before it comes out.
Nice. So I would say that which fuels the other bigger difference is that the business mentality of trying to build some sort of movie where the studios hope will ensure its success. That is, make a profit within its first weekend. That's why they have to put so much money into it in the first place. Getting the right star, negotiating their fee, getting the right co-star, and negotiating the right fee for that, and which includes their commitment to promoting the film before it's released, all the advertising, all the outlets that you can advertise through, and then a saturation with a few days leading up to that. It adds up to a lot of money, and therefore you're taking a bigger risk because you hope that not only will you make your money back, but you'll, and then some during that first weekend in theatrical sales alone. In the old days, could you imagine a discussion that would be similar to a discussion that must be held by studios today, where Louis B. Mayer sat with his people discussing how are we gonna approach the adaptation of Gone with the Wind? Can we come up with Rhett Butler action figures?
Mm-hmm.
what about Scarlett O'Hara lunchboxes and Happy Meals? And how can we tweak this so we can play in the Asian markets? Those conversations never happened. And they never happened. They did not happen until as recently as the late 1990s, because up until that point, the foreign markets were not that important. Films used to be released like maybe half a year later than they were released in the United States. I remember this. I lived in Europe, folks, in the 80s. I was like, I would have to like go to America on my summer vacations to see a recently released film because it wouldn't show up in Swiss theaters, even British theaters, till sometimes 6 months afterwards. Although England, they tend to release films around the same time.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I think that was the case in places like Japan, which is now one of the larger markets. And we haven't even gotten the whole, like, how piracy has affected the business as well. Mm-hmm. That's a whole other story. But, yeah, it's so incredibly different from the way it used to be. That to simply reduce the argument to, it's just another genre.
Nope.
It is completely missing the point of what's happening here.
It's also becoming more like, I guess, what Spielberg and Lucas were saying. Like, it's becoming more of a luxury now to go into the movies because of the high ticket prices and using 3D as that outlet to have the high ticket prices and to create more of a larger experience. And it really could legitimately get to that point where, like, the little movies that you see that... Like, the other thing you're seeing now, too, is a number of big-name actors who are now going to Netflix and signing deals to put their films out because, in time, the multiplexes are going to be just mostly event pictures, and they're going to be played for the massive audiences that are going to go run out and see Star Wars. They're going to want to see the next Marvel movie. They're willing to pay that money to go see it in the theaters versus seeing it at home, and... Those smaller films are just going to be more like, you know, what you see on Netflix that you could just binge on and not think twice about having to spend the extra fee for your popcorn and soda.
Or it will be like video on demand where you can just sit at home and watch it and not have to worry about the exorbitant fee of going to the theater and seeing it.
Well, that's something we need to get into, too, like the new distribution models and how that's affecting the economy. I want to get back to the point of audiences. Movie-going audiences are different today than they were even 2 decades ago.
Oh, yes.
These are people that are, it's a whole generation of people raised on the Internet and therefore immediate access to entertainment. They can watch where they want to watch on the commute to work, you know? And so there's a mentality out there, well, if I'm going to like spend all this money to go to see a movie, I'd rather it be a big budget popcorn flick.
Yeah.
Where it's an experience, even though I would argue, well, is it really that enjoyable an experience? I mean, are the Transformers films really worth that $15 price tag? I personally don't think so.
Of course.
But that same thing is like, that's why I'd rather see something, you know, like Killer Joe in the comfort of my own home. I wouldn't be willing to spend $15 to see that, you know, which perpetuates the problem.
Yeah. And then, you know, like even if you wanted to go see a movie like Killer Joe, I mean, not all of us in the United States have access to go to an independent theater to see it, especially if its release is very limited.
Right. And we're speaking as film fans.
Yeah. Exactly.
A majority of people, we're talking about American public, right?
Oh, yeah.
When they go out to see a movie, they're going for an escape. They're going on a date. It's an excuse to go out with a bunch of buddies. And it's an excuse for the parents to either escape the family or find something to do with the family outside of what they usually do. And a lot of people don't decide what they're going to see until they get to the multiplex and they look at the list of films playing and say, oh, yeah, that's coming up. Let's see that. That looks good.
Yep. Yeah, because, I mean, it's even, as you were saying about, you know, deciding what to see on the big screen, I find a lot of people would rather go to see, let's say, Jurassic World for the experience, because there you're going to have the, like, superior sound, the sharper picture, rather than, you know, you might not have the best system at home to watch it on. So you kind of feel like you're more in the film. And as you said, you can escape more watching the big budget film in the theater. Whereas when you, let's say, watch a drama, you want to be captivated, but you're not so much worried about sound, sharpness, and feeling like you're taken away, you know, in the experience as much.
And it's like what Billy Donnelly said a couple of years ago. It's like going to a restaurant, opening up the menu, and say you see like a hamburger on the menu. You know what you're going to expect when you buy that hamburger, and you know what it's going to taste like, smell like. And if you see something else that you're recommended to, you're going to be a little more reluctant because you may not know what that taste is going to be like. You may be disappointed. You may want to take it back or have your money back if it's not cooked the right way. So like somebody who knows nothing about the trailers and but may know what Jurassic Park is, they see the title on that screen above the ticket counter, they're going to more likely go for that because they know what they're getting themselves into.
Well, it's also, that's how, like, those guys who make those knockoff movies, like, instead
Asylums?
Huh?
Asylum?
Well, no, not necessarily only them, but, you know, like the sci-fi movies you see on the sci-fi channel.
Right, and most of them are Asylum films.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So, yeah, it's they're hoping for that so that if somebody's looking through a directory of what to watch, even when it comes to television, they'll see, like, oh, it has Jurassic in it, so it must be a part of Steven Spielberg's, and then it's really, like, Jurassic Dino versus Mega Shark.
Yeah.
You know? Keep in mind, I just want to clarify something. There's nothing wrong if you like these films. And I'm not saying that good films can't come out of this business model. The point is it has changed the business of film. It's not, the intention is not to make a good film. The intention is to create a brand.
And to make money.
That has longevity so that you can continue to pull revenue out of that. And that didn't exist before. That's what's new about now. And that is affecting the economy. Getting back to, it's kind of like the analogy is our own, like, national economy. There's no more middle class. You're either poor or you're rich, right?
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with the film industry. It's either a really expensive movie or it's a really inexpensive movie. And the inexpensive movies are being muscled out of the theaters. The best they get is a limited theatrical release, and they go straight to VOD, which is an interesting distribution model, but it's untested. To this day, people still aren't sure how it actually works and how much money they're actually making off of VOD.
Yeah, so basically, like a movie like Snowpiercer, which we all praised, I don't know how much money that's made or if anybody's seen any kind of profit out of it, but yet it's popular enough now that people are renting it. We just don't know what it's grossing.
Exactly. Yeah, so, yeah, I think it's a really interesting topic. That's why we're going to get more Star Wars films. You know, that's why we're going to continue to see the build up or build on to the Marvel Cinematic Universe. That's why we're going to have a whole Warner Brothers DC universe. These are recognizable brands. You can create merchandising out of them, you know, and that's the big difference between the Hollywood of today and the Hollywood of yesterday. Hollywood of yesterday, they were in the movie making business. The Hollywood today, they're in the profit making business.
Yeah.
Now, that's not to say that the Hollywood of yesterday weren't interested in – I'm sure they wanted their films to make a profit. But because not only were the actors, directors, everybody, their employees, but they owned the movie theaters. So the overhead wasn't there that exists now. And so they would have a rich portfolio of content that if one thing failed, something else would succeed. You didn't like the Western? You might like this musical. You don't like this musical? You might like this film more.
You're also talking about a time, too, where the corporations, like before the 70s, the corporations didn't really own the studios. So most of these people that were calling the shots were guys who had their hand on how the scripts were done. And as you said, they assigned the actors to contracts for that specific studio. But once you had like Transamerica taking over United Artists and Coca-Cola taking over Columbia Pictures in the 80s, like little things like that, it started to become not people. It got worse in the 90s with the global corporations, but it wasn't people who
right.
understood making movies and telling good stories. It became lawyers, bankers, international moguls saying, pump this film out and make it for this budget and have all this merchandise out. They don't give a shit about who's directing, who's starring. They want to get that release date out and make their profit for the year.
Well, that's what Steven Soderbergh said in his speech. He mentioned that like today's studio heads don't know movies.
Yeah.
They may not even like movies. And I personally don't know a studio head, so I can't confirm that. But, you know, I've heard that sentiment expressed a lot by a lot of people in the industry.
Well, it's because it's just another product to them. It doesn't mean anything as much as it might mean to the audience that they're producing it for.
Right. Exactly. So, you know, I mean, you could sit here and say, okay, I'm going to start my own little indie studio, maybe kickstart funds, right? Give a couple of interesting director friends an opportunity to do whatever they want. This budget, as long as you stick within this budget, and that budget includes advertising, but as long as you stick to that, and you can make whatever you want. Just make whatever you want. Theoretically, if that film was made for under, say, $100,000, including the advertising budget, and it was a decent film, is it possible to make money off that by just sticking to the current distribution models, VOD, straight to DVD, whatever? I don't know. I mean, it gets into the other argument, like will that film find an audience, period, right?
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, we return to what I mentioned before, Blumhouse, where there's a lot of these films that aren't getting released that was made under their banner, and it's probably because a lot of those films actually weren't very good. So we can romanticize this all we want, say I have a better idea for a business model, but what it comes down to is make sure you make a good movie.
Yeah, that's both ways, no yeah. doubt.
But, yeah, so I think it's an interesting subject. Do you guys have anything more to say about it?
I could go on and on, but I guess we've exhausted it.
Well, yeah, I think this is a good end point. We've been already podcasting about an hour and a half. It's our usual standard length. Give us your thoughts. Rate us, comment on us on iTunes, but give us your thoughts on our page on This Is Infamous when this goes up online. You have the opportunity to respond in the comments section. Or respond within our Facebook group when this is linked to our Facebook group. So, yeah. And I know a lot of you have some interesting thoughts on this because that conversation thread that inspired this discussion, there's a lot of interesting input there on both sides of the fence. So, anyway. So, that concludes this week's podcast, Podcast 17. Make sure you follow us on Twitter. Follow us individually on Twitter. Like us on our Facebook page, join our Facebook group, and join the CineFiles-like discussions we have there. Jeff, Andre, and I contribute so you can interact with us. And Michael Foltz, hopefully he'll be returning soon. He's dealing with a lot of family, personal, just getting all sorts of stuff, you know, in line on that end. And hopefully he'll be returning with us soon in case you miss him.
We love you, Mike.
We love you, Mike. And having said that, goodbye. Andre Joseph, say your goodbyes.
Sayonara.
Jeff, say your goodbyes.
Until next time.
Same bat time, same bat channel. This is Eric Cohen signing off. Have a good weekend.
The CineFiles podcast is a part of This Is Infamous Radio and This Is Infamous Media. Executive produced by Billy Donnelly and Eric Cohen. 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 And Eric Cohen.